Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. We might get going. I might have a few people trickling in, but we'll get moving. My name's James McHale. I'm from the ABC, and thanks very much for UWA for having me here today. We're going to have a panel discussion, which is probably going to kind of tie in together a few of the things that you might have seen throughout the day and discuss some pretty big topics. So thanks very much for coming in today, and you know, it's a Sunday, so which I'm sure you're all aware of. So for giving up your time today to come down, we appreciate it. I'll just introduce the panel as quickly as possible, because if I went through their entire bios, then we'd probably run out of time. They're a very impressive bunch. We'll start with Hackett Professor Kadamot Sadiq. Is the Hackett Professor of Agricultural Chair and Director of the UWA's Institute of Agriculture. He has 30 years of experience in agricultural research, teaching and management in both Australia and overseas, and is an international expert in agricultural science, especially in the fields of crop physiology, production agronomy, farming systems, genetic resources, breeding research in cereal, grain and pasture legumes, and oilseed crops. And he's published more than 300 scientific papers and book chapters, and is taking a break from writing those to come here today to be with us. To his right is Dr. Andrew Gazzomi, who is an agricultural engineer whose research focuses on devising novel engineering solutions to challenging and relevant global agricultural problems. He uses his interest in engineering, the environment and humanity to develop more efficient systems for our sustainable future and to render lab science practical, which is a very noble pursuit indeed. It's good to see. His focus on research and development of practical agricultural engineering solutions to deal with industry problems and engineering education to shape future generations. And last year was awarded the WA Innovator of the Year. Next to him is Professor Anu Ramahan, a professor of economics at the University of WA and the Director of International Relations, Faculty of Arts, Business Law and Education. Her recent research has focused on two areas: intra-household distribution of health and education in developing countries and its implications for the households, children, women and the elderly, and food and nutritional security in rural areas of developing countries. Lachlan Hunter is next to her. He's from a mixed cropping and merino sheep farm in the state's central wheat belt. Oh, no, he's not, sorry.
No, we got time.
That's it. The configuration of the chairs has changed. Apologies. He is a graduate from the WA College of Agriculture in Cunderdin and is currently studying a Bachelor of Science in Agriculture with a major in Political Science and International Relations. And before this, before attending UWA, he completed a year-long cadetship at Intergrain as a plant breeding technician, which saw him travel to many of the grain-growing regions of Australia, experiencing new and innovative technology in genetic agriculture. Finally is Assistant Professor Siobhan Hickling, who is a research dietitian with 20 years' experience in public health research, teaching and practice. And while completing her doctorate, Siobhan worked as a research dietitian for the Food Group Australia and also teaches undergraduates and postgraduates about food and nutrition and population health in population health, discussing and debating issues of optimal food patterns for disease prevention, taking into account sustainable food supplies for today and into the future. Whew. All right. Now that the bona fides of our panel is established, so what's going to happen is we're just going to have a broad chat about some of the issues that you will have discussed today, about food security, feeding the future. It's a small, you know, relatively small group, which is really nice. So if anyone has any questions at any point, we're not going to do a question time at the end or whatever. Just we don't quite jump in, but if you can get my attention by giving me a wave, I'll send a microphone up and we'll put your question to the panel. So don't be sure. Was that a practice? You scratch your head at the right time. Yeah, it's okay. That was a practice. That was a good waving technique. And you can jump in and ask a question. So I think it might be good to sort of start, and you know, whoever wants to jump in with this, please jump in, but you know, what is this, how bad is the situation at the moment in regards to global food security or food shortages? I mean, Can we get a bit of a context of where we are?
I think it's pretty good when compared with the 2008 figures, because of 2008-10, that time, the global food production was pretty low, and there was only something like 14 to 28 days of food in the store. In other words, you know, the grains and so on. But since then, a number of countries got together, and the production has increased, for example, in the case of wheat and so on. But that's a short-term approach. But if you look at the population, 7.5 billion today, and prediction is that anything between 9.5 to 10 billion by 2050. That is quite accurate. Then we need to increase the production at least, remember, 70% more food than what we produce. So that's a mammoth task without having new land available, and technologies are coming, but also the demand is growing, when I say not in terms of quantity alone, but quality. So we have a great challenge out there in order to feed the 10 billion people by 2050.
So that's a 70% increase in...
At least a 70% is that. But on the top of that, we have some serious issues. The climate is changing very, very significantly in different parts of the world. Drying, heating up, flash floods, and so on. So that is affecting the production. And if you look at the major crops like rice, wheat, and maize, which is the staple, the rate of improvement in productivity is slowed down. So we are in a situation where that's happening. Then we got three things happening. One is still we need calorie to feed the people. There is malnutrition and hidden hunger. And on the top of that, we have what we call obesity, up to 1 billion people, both in developing countries as well as developed countries. So it's a triple whammy, if you like.
And you do get these situations in countries like, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think Indonesia, where you have at one end of the scale malnutrition, and then because of the industrialization, developing middle class, you then have this obesity kind of bubble that is emerging as well. It's a sort of...
It is about a billion people are currently obese, and of course, significant amount of adults and young people. It's not just because they're eating a lot of food, but also the wrong food, junk food. Mm. All those things are contributing.
Mm-hmm. And is this... is it an economic issue, Anu? Is it an issue with poverty in terms of the... the access to food, the lack of access to food, or is it a technological issue? You know, how much does poverty play into it?
That's a good question, James. Thanks. So I think there is a problem with access to food to the billions of people around the world, and this access and distribution is particularly a problem in developing countries. So food production is not the problem. For instance, take a country like India, which is actually a food exporter. At the same time, we find that significant numbers of people in India are malnourished, and that's because it's a distribution problem. The food is not reaching the poor that really require it. Mm. So we have this paradox of, on the one hand, we have these people that are malnourished, and at the same time, we have obesity. Mm. So it's not just about food production, it's about access to food, it's about food being wasted, and it's about poor farmers not having access to the technology and the infrastructure, and a lot of food being wasted at the farm gate. Mm-hmm. It's being produced, but it's not reaching the retail sector. And also in the developed world, we find that food that's being produced is wasted at the supermarket end because it's not aesthetically looking good.
Yes.
So it gets thrown out.
Yeah. So is that a universal problem?
Yeah, it is a universal problem. Yeah. And it's also happening in developing countries. So the paradox also is that the people that are producing the food are the ones that are living in poverty. So it's the poor farmers and it's the... the livestock owners and fishermen in developing countries, which have the highest numbers of hungry people, and it's a paradox.
Mm. Yeah. So, is that an economic issue in that it is more economically beneficial to export food rather than keep it domestic?
Yeah, I think part of the problem is some of the agricultural policies have focused on cash crops.
Yep.
So farmland is being used for cash crops, so the people are not able to grow the food that they require for their own consumption. So they're relying on the markets. So when there is a food shock or when the food prices increase, then they are paying the international prices. So that is part of the problem, yes. But and also because they don't have access to the technology, the hybrid fertilizer, and grains and fertilizers, they are not able to compete and participate in the global food markets.
How do you, I guess one of the dangers of having a free market approach to agriculture is that, you know, you sacrifice staple crops maybe for cash crops. Does it work when you have a situation like in Indonesia where the government intervenes in order to try to stabilize that?
That can also be a problem because when there is an increase in prices, sometimes the governments intervene and stop exports. For instance, Thailand and Indonesia stopped exports of rice when there was an increase in food prices for rice. The idea was to protect their farmers from secure the food for their own consumption. But what that meant was that their farmers couldn't get access to the high prices that overseas consumers were prepared to pay. And there is a difference between the fact that it doesn't mean that if the prices are high, it's the domestic, sometimes the farmers who produce the food also purchase food. So there's a difference between net purchasers and net producers.
Can I just briefly jump in? I think the point which I know making is very important. If you look at it globally, there are 527 million small farmers. When I say small farmers, they have less than 1 acre. In many cases, it's 0.10 acres. So these 527 million farmers are the producers of 70% of the world's food. And only 10 to 15% of the food is globally traded, coming from countries like Australia or United States and so on. So this is a very important point because the same people doesn't have access to food, as Anu said, or doesn't have the technology to produce more. So if you want to see more production by 2050, then we must empower the small farmers. Again, I emphasize that 527 million farmers through technology, through social reforms, the fair trade policies, and so on. If they don't get that, they will move out of agriculture. In fact, that's already happening. If you look at the world's population, 50% currently reside in rural areas, 50% in urban areas. By 2050, the number's going to change. The people will be 70% in urban areas and only 30% in rural areas. Who is going to do this agriculture? We'll talk about that later.
So I'll chip in a little bit. So this morning I talked around this, obviously, from an engineering point of view. And so I think there's some drivers here, as Sadiq mentioned, with the arable land, the amount of land we have available for farming. We're into the future, we're likely going to have, in simple terms, less land available as we urbanise and start living on more of it. And we see that even here in Perth as we start to have subdivisions across, say, market gardens and things. So we need to get more efficient at our land use and increase our yields from that area that we have available. And technology clearly has a role to play, and Australia is a good example. We're well aware that it costs a lot to employ people to do jobs, and we've seen some issues with the 457 visa, et cetera, with backpackers needed for picking fruit, et cetera. So I think engineering solutions can step up to that challenge into the future, and I think robots will become more prevalent in that space in decades to come. But in saying that, and I think back to the economic drivers, we do need economic drivers to help facilitate that innovation, and we are a first world country, and I think we can have some spin outs too from a manufacturing point of view by actually coming up with solutions that can work here and then be implemented across other parts of the world.
Is the cost of it a problem? I mean, is that part of the, is it expensive to innovate in agriculture technology? Does it have to be?
Interesting here. I always try and think sort of quite big. I think it's always going to be expensive and risky to innovate, but I think it's easier to do that early than later. So it'll probably be more expensive later and have bigger implications and cost us a lot more if we get it wrong. So I think the timing is now to start doing that. I don't know. I think that's...
Yeah, I guess... I suppose there's... when you think of agricultural innovation or any technological innovation, you know, you kind of think about bigger and better and, or, you know, smaller and better, and increasing technology where there are some often low-tech solutions that can be very effective. I'm not sure if, perhaps maybe if you can have a think about whether you've come across an example of that, but...
Yeah. I think the technology will vary. Again, we must remember we should not keep Australia as the main driver. So it comes to the 527 million farmers. We need to have smaller scale technologies, small scale mechanization. We are not going to see young people, particularly in those countries, 35% of the population is below 25, 30 years. They're not going to come and transplant rice by hand and so on. So we need to see small scale mechanization. And that's where people like Andrew can innovate at the higher end and then work with those countries and then develop technologies needed for those countries and then empower them, because the youth has to come back to the farm. If they want to come back to the farm, it must be profitable, it must be sustainable. How do we do that? There's going to be demand in the supermarkets. That's how I see the developing countries going to contribute food production, quality food, security, and into the supermarkets. And technology is absolutely vital, both economic technology as well as engineering technology and so on.
Thanks for the compliment. I don't think I'll achieve at all. Hopefully I will contribute. But I think as James mentioned, and Sadiq, I think the technologies, they need to be adopted or adoptable. So they need to actually be practical solutions that can be taken up by farmers readily now and progressed and developed with the farmers' input, et cetera, et cetera. No point us as researchers coming up with some amazing innovation that is whiz-bang if it just stays in our lab and goes nowhere. And I think that's a good thing that we're doing.
Yeah, or there's one example of it needs to be, I guess, sustainable, driven by the community. You know, there's NGOs in East Timor that have, you know, they were sort of on a program to put wells into villages, which was great, but then once the well broke down, nobody knew how to fix it, and the government hadn't agreed to do that, so they all had a well that was completely useless. So it's, which is, I think, also something that, it'd be interesting, actually, Andrew, to see what you think about this, but, you know, you can get a sort of, you know, the danger of designing things and trying to implement things without, from very, very far away, without going there and checking it out.
Exactly. So I have a bit of first-hand experience with this. So the particular research projects I lead, they typically do have farmer consultants involved and industry partners, et cetera, for exactly that same reason. And it also probably helps if you have a moral standpoint where you're hoping to come up with something and not hoping to maybe add the service element so that your business model is linked to actually, you know, having the industry come in to fix it. I think if we can empower, especially in these remote communities and these 527 million farmers, if they can actually fix their systems, then that's highly important. And that even is relevant in our grains industry here in Australia. We have farmers on really big properties. They're remotely located. If they have a problem with some advanced hydraulic system or et cetera, like by the time they get a technician to come out from the city or somewhere, like they've missed their window or whatever it was for applying their herbicide or harvesting their crop or whatever it is. And so Australian farmers are very capable, but like we need all the farmers to be there and able to fix their implements and things.
I work in news, so literally everything is a crisis or an epidemic or a pandemic. I don't know if you've noticed. The obesity issue, you know, just how bad is it? How concerning, is it?
Yeah, it's a really good question, and it was interesting when you said, how bad is it at the beginning? And in doing a bit of reading for the panel, I was trying to see what we are doing positively, because one of your questions is, what are we doing right?
Yes.
Can we do more of it? It took me some time. It certainly didn't come naturally, because I guess the news is all negative, the research is all negative. There's not a lot in diet terms that we are actually doing positive for our health and for feed in the future. Within Australia, we have not that much National Nutrition Survey data, but there was a large one in 1995 and one again around 2012 that we do have good data on. And overall, the obesity crisis is going up. And so in order to feed people that have to carry that extra weight around, they need more calories just to survive and just to take those that extra weight up the stairs. So we have seen that increase, and what's alarming is it's now more or less the norm. We've got more than 50% of the population either overweight or obese, and so when you look around, your normal is someone who is overweight or obese. And within my undergraduate student classes, I often show them pictures of someone who's underweight, normal weight, overweight, and all the various categories of morbidly obese without the labels on, and get them to pick which one they think is normal. They go to the first stage of overweight. That's what they believe is normal, because we just don't have a reference for what a healthy weight is anymore. But to say what we are doing right in looking at those two surveys, we do seem to be consuming less sugar-sweetened beverages, and that's certainly something that the news is or has been hitting hard. So there has been some groundswell around that. We do seem to be cutting back on our sweetened beverages that we're drinking and drinking more water, which is positive.
Okay. Do you think, like I personally, if I'm changing, you know, I'm trying to, particularly this year, was trying to be healthier. And I found that if I don't do one thing at a time, like I get overwhelmed by everything. So something like cutting out, you know, I cut out beers, for instance.
Well done.
So, you know, congratulations to me. But, you know, is that the way you've got to take it on like on a macro level as well? Like something, can you only do one thing at a time? Or
look, that's really tricky. And that's where we don't have a good answer and we need more research, is how do we actually change eating behaviour? Because we've known what to do for years and years. You know, it's really, we just need to eat what our parents told us, you know, more fruit and veg. And even if we were eating according to the Australian dietary guidelines, we would be improving or we would make more food available for the future than what we're currently eating. We're eating so much processed food that's packaged and travelled so far that doesn't necessarily contribute the nutrients that we need.
Yeah,
it does
okay.
give us the energy and the calories, but not the nutrients.
Yeah.
So if we could revert back to that, that would be great. And how we actually do that is tricky. One thing that we do see from the research is that people that have a strong motivation for behaviour change have much more success in making that change. So someone who's had a recent heart attack is much more motivated to lose weight or to eat healthy, or someone who's had a cancer scare is also similarly motivated. What I'm wondering is if we are amassing enough of a groundswell around climate change to really be using that as a motivator as well to help people to change their dietary behaviour. And that's a question we don't have the answer for, but you know, something.
And what are the climate change considerations for diet?
Well, the Australian Dietary Guidelines for a number of years have considered food for the future and a sustainable food supply, but they haven't, in my opinion, really brought it in hard enough. But then there's not the research in that area really to support it. So they do have some reference to it. But really, the Australian Dietary Guidelines talks about the various food groups. It doesn't highlight that we should perhaps be eating, you know, more legumes rather than beef, etc. It just gives the broad food group categories. And perhaps there's room for some guidelines to go along with the Australian Dietary Guidelines that will provide more food.
But in terms of the effect that dietary decisions can have on climate change, contributing to it or helping it. That's things like, is it the methane produced by beef production?
Right.
Is it...
Look, that's a really good question, and I don't really have the answer to that. But I think human methane production is much less than what we see from cattle.
Okay.
So I think what we can do is get humans to eat less cattle to make that change.
Yeah, so those kind of things. Did you?
Well, I think if you take average a kilogram of food, you need 15 to 20 times more energy producing beef. So whether it is water or producing more grain, and they're all contributing to the greenhouse gas, whether in the form of CO2, methane, or nitrous oxide. So there is no reason why people can't eat more vegetarian. But of course, so this is a big question. If you look at the developing countries, oil consumption has gone up, sugar consumption is going up, meat consumption is going up. So next to 50 years, you will see significant increase in consumption of meat, milk, dairy products, sugar, oil, cooking oil, etc., in developing countries. So they are from a low base. It's okay for Australia and United States to talk about it because we are taking huge amount. US meat consumption is in the range of 150 kilograms per person per year, whereas go to Indonesia, it is less than 2 kilograms per person per year. If they move into 4 kilograms, multiplied by the number, the quantity of methane, et cetera, is going to go up. So there's a lot of ethical issues. It's easy for us to say that, but there's clear evidence that changing diet from meat, overloading meat into a plant-based food will reduce the carbon footprint on the planet. There's no doubt. So we need to educate. How do we do that? Yeah, it's a big...
If I could just add to that, one thing that we've done, it's not positive, but one thing we've done effectively in the Western world is exported our diet to the emerging economies. No country has really successfully made the transition from high levels of malnutrition to good nutrition. It's gone from malnutrition to more obesity. So that dietary change there really has not been well managed.
Mm.
And if I could just pop in there,
of course. James,
if Siobhan is right, because I think the especially in the Western world, we've been enabled to have all this food in front of us. So that overconsumption can only happen normally, I suppose. But I think the commentary that, you know, especially around diets and what we should and shouldn't eat, I think we can that can get lost in, some of the aspects around the image of agriculture, because the image of agriculture is at the moment probably not a very good one.
Okay.
And you know, we are the second biggest industry that contributes to greenhouse gases. And I think that if we had a solution around, you know, the genetic technology around agriculture or agricultural engineering that provided less greenhouse gas emission, then I reckon that argument around what we should and shouldn't eat would be an easier one to have.
Yeah. That issue of GMO, how is that? How much of a factor is that at the moment in agriculture in a place like Australia?
I think Sadiq may have be better equipped to answer that question.
I think we'll come back to the GMO later. So let us stick with this thing. But there's a question from a young lady.
I was just going to ask. I had a question related to kind of the concept of thinking local with this kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And obviously, we're really encouraged to do that when we're shopping. Kind of think about the local kind of area. I was just wondering, in terms of for developing countries, say that concept did expand, and obviously it's not going to happen overnight, but if we did go back to being local, how that would impact on developing countries with their exports and things like that.
If I may, just for a second, and then someone else can jump in with the actual second part
of
the question.
I'll answer that,
It's just because it's slightly related to what we're talking about beforehand. So I think the education thing has a huge role to play, and people becoming more aware of actually their food choices and what the implications of what they're choosing actually means. So we're very used to eating whatever we want, whenever we want, regardless of the season, for example. I think that's touching on your point. Like, some of us don't even know when it is in season to buy bananas or whatever it is. So I think that's one thing. So there's obviously that comes back to the greenhouse gas emissions and stuff of transport, and is it make sense to have things flowing or on ships coming across the world, et cetera. And then in terms of export or whatever, even like water security, if we're putting them into vegetables and plants and then exporting them, we've lost that water from our system. It's gone into some place in Europe, whatever, into their sewage system. And then back to the cattle issue, I think education there around, and there is a bit of a movement in this direction around like secondary cuts and actually eating the whole animal. It gave up its life for us. You know, maybe we shouldn't just eat the fillet steak, and like it was this big animal, it had lots of meat.
I don't know if that will be much consolation to the animal, but it's probably good.
Yeah, I won't stay on good. There because of that.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, so I definitely think there is a good movement and trend around community gardens and things. Many of us would have grown up with a big backyard. Unfortunately, there's now these trends to have the house over the whole block and no vegetable garden or anything. That'd probably get us more active if we were digging our own garden. It would get our kids out there seeing the garden, would know what's in season, et cetera, et cetera. I don't have to flesh that out much more than that.
I think your question is quite valid, particularly in developing countries. If you look at globally, again, the three crops dominate: rice, wheat, and maize. So much of diversity lost from the system. So that's partly because of the industrialization. People get cash returns. So they neglected what we call underutilized crops. I don't like to call the neglected crops. So that's sweet potato, rich in vitamin A. Some of the vegetables, the leafy vegetables, jackfruit, papaya, mango, all those things contribute so much of dense nutrients to the vulnerable community, but they are not growing. If you take, for example, Cambodia, 80% of the protein is coming from rice. Rice has got only 6% protein. They get a little bit of fish and things. So how that community is going to build up? Yet there are now a lot of proteinaceous crops and leafy vegetables they used to grow in the past. They're all gone out of the system because dictated by the economy. If they grow maize, they grow rice, they get cash. That cash can be used for educating the children and so on. So there are social issues I know coming in relation to that. So I'm heading a United Nations FAO program on neglected and underutilized crops where we're mapping the whole area and asking people questions. What are the key crops? Why you are not growing? Then what is needed is that government should bring the policy. Government should not give subsidy for growing rice after rice after rice. Yes, you need some rice. What we call crop planning, based on the geographical location, you plan the whole country. X area will produce X amount of rice. Y area will produce leafy vegetables and so on. As a nation, then you can have a prosperous, nutritious people growing up.
So just to add to that, it's not just the producers as well, as we've pointed out, also the consumers. As their incomes increase, they tend to focus their diets on just, like Siddiq was saying, just mainly staple crops. So the increased income is spent on, say, junk food, chips, sweets, and so on. So what we're seeing is that there is no diversity in the diets. Mm-hmm. So the diet is the same as what a poor farmer would have, except they're having more quantity. And that means that their nutrition is not very good. So the reason we say that it's good to eat locally produced food is because it puts less pressure on the transport system, so that what we find is when oil prices increase, then there is a significant relationship with food prices as well, because they're relying on transport to transport food, processed food. So if you were, many farmers in developing countries don't really produce for the market. It's mainly subsistence farming, and the food that is produced is often, they don't have the processing technology or the marketing, the supply chain's not there. So it doesn't reach from the farm gate to the supermarkets. So a lot of it is wasted, a lot of food is wasted by harvest losses or by pests or by lack of infrastructure, refrigeration technology, and so on. So, yeah.
If I could just add to that, and I like your concept, and I think especially in Western Australia, and I'll use one example, is Bannister Downs Dairy, that you get, the milk in your cool vac packs, and I think it's around consumer behaviour. And I think we as responsible citizens, I think, can come together and create a bit of a campaign and, not buy the Coles and Woolworths dollar a litre milk and actually go out there and proactively buy local food and produce. But it's hard, and from someone from a farming family, you know, you're creating a high quality product in Western Australia's wheat belt. But you as a small farmer don't have the capacity in the economic environment to go and do that. So, you know, we'd love to have a flour mill on our farm and create bread and, you know, sell it to the boat sheds of Cottesloe in the world, but you just physically can't do that. So the environment that we're in and the reality that we're in is that, we, you know, we have two Coles and Woolworths that are on competing value chains and supply chains, and the dollar milks, you know, the mums and dads, that is convenient for them in their local economy or what they have in their own budget at home, is convenient. And, you know, if you want to go and buy your fruit and veg from one spot and go to the butcher, and, you know, it's a logistical nightmare for some people to do it. So
I think, and it's expensive.
Yeah, it is.
Well,
yeah.
Relatively.
Yeah.
Right, you know. Mm.
So I think we need to be responsible social citizens and proactively get food locally.
Yeah.
Sure, we'll just grab the microphone. Just hang on.
Just along the same lines, is there anything, not from an individual level, but from a government level, that could aid us in kind of buying locally rather than going to like the big two corporations type of thing? Because, I mean, it's like, on an individual level, how many people will be able to make that sacrifice, which, it, like, of doing that every day? I mean, it's easy for people who are motivated to say, yes, I'll buy locally, but there's a large minority of people who are not going to do that without some kind of an incentive to do that.
I think we are quite lucky in Australia. If you go to a supermarket, it doesn't matter, any supermarket, 70 to 80% of the fresh food is produced within Australia. So we are so lucky in that sense. But take Singapore. I was just in Hong Kong, just came this morning, or to Dubai. There's no much choice. They have to have the food from elsewhere. So we will still see a significant amount of food shipped from one part of the world to the other where they don't have. But try to eat fresh food, fresh fruits, etc. Then you indirectly will go to local food, because if you transport it and store it, etc., it won't be that good. In fact, there is a movement in Western Australian wheat belt. Some of the farmers have got together, and they're now producing what we call protected agriculture, the glasshouses, where the solar energy and some of the water we could desalinize, and then intensively produce some of the veggies and not really fruits. And then instead of waiting in for 20 days to reach that place, you could have locally supplied. So I think that will happen. In Europe, there is a movement now. That brings to me one of the major challenges. As I mentioned earlier, 70% of the population will be urbanized in 2050, meaning that they will demand food within the cities. So peri-urban, urban agriculture need to take place. For that, we need to have a more modern design of cities. Architects and others need to come. So agriculture is only one thing. The agriculture, sustainability, food security, food safety, peace, all these things are intertwined. We can't look at it in one, just a silo mentality, $100,000 project to Professor Lynn Abbott and fix the whole world. That is not going to happen. We need larger mega themes, and that's why the University of Western Australia today has this Feeding the Future theme, cutting across different faculties. And that's one of the challenges in the university, where Institute of Agriculture has been given the mandate to integrate. Don't just look within one faculty, one school.
Yeah. Is that
a little bit of plugging?
Well, yeah, is that one of the challenges? I'd imagine that the faculties would have been historically quite separate. So is this a new approach to bring them together under this?
I think the universities are notoriously inward-looking. I hope my vice chancellor is not here. notoriously inward-looking. In particular, people look at in their own discipline, because they have been bred egotic people. The scientists are egotic people. But once you move from one faculty, one discipline to the other, integrate the big ticket item, whether it is the food security, whether it is the climate change, whether it is the ocean blue economy, we can tackle that much more vigorously, sustainably, than otherwise chip with the individuals. Mm. So, but the universities are changing rapidly because you have to deliver to the community. You have to look at the big picture. Small things happen. So, yes. Mm.
Well, the Feeding the Future challenge is it's very complicated. Like, it affects every aspect of society, et cetera, et cetera. So the only place that solutions are going to come from is from this multidisciplinary approach. And so I think that's quite clear. Yeah,
it's also, I think the thing that I find, interesting, interesting is not quite the word, but, you know, those issues have always been, we have been removed from those issues in Australia to an extent, and, you know, we're starting to see, I suppose the intake of asylum seekers is one example of, a push factor of an event that's happening out in the world kind of affecting us or bringing it into our consciousness. And I feel like as the population increases and the climate dries, we're not going to be able to ignore, you know, these things. If we think we've got problems now, flash forward 20 or 30 years.
It's interesting because, I mean, the southwest of Western Australia is one of the first places in the world to really have started to adapt to climate change. I mean, the rainfall that we see now is completely different to before the 70s. And I'm probably speaking not from the research, but just from an interest point of view, and I'm sure that you guys could back me up here, but the farming community within the southwest has adapted so much to that change in the lack of rainfall. But yet it hasn't affected the food that we eat or the supplies in the supermarket. And if anything, the food environment has changed to bring more food products and processed foods right in front of us. So in terms of cross-disciplinary, it's interesting to hear you talk about architecture. The built environment is one thing that we're starting to look at a lot in terms of physical activity as well as diet. And if you think of the food environments that you've probably all come through just to get here today, you've probably passed plenty of opportunities to get, instant food or food products. Mm. But you probably haven't passed that many places where you can get your fresh fruit and vegetables. Mm.
And you sort of also, I feel like you're battling the fact that there is so much misleading food marketing that is telling people that things are healthy that aren't healthy. Plus, and I don't know how much you come into contact with this, but this sort of sense of which certain commentators in the media are keen to emphasise of this, don't tell me what I should be eating, there was one example recently in New South Wales. It was one of the East Coast states where they had mandated that 3/4 of the food in the cafeteria had to be freshly made. And then this particular person got up and said, people don't want to be told what to feed their kids. Like, they're not telling you what to feed your kids.
But what they need
what they're doing is, you can feed them what you like. Yeah. But if they're going to the canteen, 3/4 of the food that's available is going to be freshly made. But it just sort of inspires this reaction in people.
They people need to be able to find healthy food and purchase healthy food if they choose to. And moves like that, making 75% of the canteen fresh food, means that they have that opportunity. Mm. One of our master's students recently did an audit of the food environment on campus to see whether people can actually get food that is healthy if they choose to. And many of the vendors really didn't meet the criteria for what was considered healthy. So there's a lot of unhealthy food out there, which is a problem. But if you are pushing positive dietary behaviour changes and you want people to eat fresh, eat locally, they need to be able to see that and access it rather than have to really travel a long way to get it.
I remember travelling in Europe in an airport and looking for a quick snack at a vending machine, as we do, and I was surprised to see in there like a packet of, say, pistachio nuts and some other things like that, where I would think in Australia you'd have like some chips and
they'd be peanuts soaked in oil and salt. Delicious oil-soaked peanuts.
But we must be careful about this as well, because if you earlier you mentioned about the food waste. So in Australia, we waste about 362 kilograms of food per person per year. That's approximately 1 kilogram is wasted. We are so obsessed with the use-by date. A lot of times that use-by date mean nothing. You can take if they, and open up and even keep in the fridge, it will be working. Of course, I understand dairy products and some of the veggies may have bruises. But that is where huge amount of food is wasted in developing world, which is perfectly all right, or banana, which has got a blemish on the peel. When you peel off, it is quite good. So we need to look at that. Otherwise, Australia will have huge problems in relation to greenhouse emission and the food security, et cetera, as the population grows. And we need to educate our children and young generation the value of the food. We don't respect food because we think that food is just so cheap, readily available. And whereas olden times, maybe our parents and grandparents struggled to have that food, there was a lot of respect. Now we don't respect it. We buy a lot, keep a lot in the fridge, we cook a lot, we throw a lot, we order a lot in the restaurants and so on. So about 30% of the global food is wasted. In the case of developing countries, it is from the supermarkets to the rubbish bin. In the developing countries, it is in the farm because they don't have storage and proper control of insects, pests, and so on.
So that cuts across lots of things we've talked about, because even back to the local markets and local producers producing things, like if you go to a farmer's market or whatever, typically the fruit or whatever might not look as good as the perfectly looking tomato in the supermarket. So that's an education thing, to actually recognise that that food will probably actually taste better than the cosmetically good-looking one. The other thing too is we do have knives in our kitchen. You can cut off that blemish or that bug out of something and just like maybe feed it to your chooks if you have some in your backyard or something. Yeah. Like it's common sense. We all talk about these European diets and the Mediterranean stuff and Italy or whatever, or Greece. And like these people, they'll grow their own produce. They'll do some activity as they grow that produce. They'll have some chooks, whatever. They'll feed the stuff. They make the use of all their meals, like Sadiq's mentioning. And then back to those like third world issues with food production. There's innovative things there that can happen, like in terms of, say, refrigeration and that, because a lot of the spoilage occurs because they're very hot climates and things, and you can't get the food out in time or the transport. So, yeah, interesting times. Yeah.
We've got a woman's been waiting very patiently. I'm sorry it's taking so long.
I think.
Oh, cool. Yep.
I'm very encouraged by the multidisciplinary approach we're seeing here, where we've got food and ag and technology and economics and health. Then we've got a budding youth and political science at that end. And thank you, James, because I'm having a take-home message for you with the media.
Yeah.
Great stuff is being said all through the day today, but the politics and then the media have a really significant role. And we're hearing, for example, from the call from the rural areas is we need to get more people on less land, and Professor Sadiq referred to that, I think, in other countries, but it actually applies here. We've got a migration of rural to the city where we want to actually be going the other way. We want to build up railways and so on. And the other one is, we talk about bridging the country-city divide, but politically, and the media even is doing the opposite all the time. We as a consumer want to see food pushed into the health part of the paper, like early in the West Australian, for example, and if we're lucky it gets in the business, or it will go through to a rural paper. And the things that are in the rural papers actually need to be in the city paper so that we can see. So there's a big one for the media to actually be inclusive of that and not push the agenda, tell us what we actually listen to us, and then drive this forward.
I think absolutely you are spot on, and we have had our aging population, particularly the farmers. But having said that, for the last 5 years, we are beginning to see a trend of young farmers taking over their parents' farm. And if I go for a field day today, let's say I go to Meriden Field Day, we are beginning to see significant number of young people coming and taking over the farm, attending the field days. These are farmers' kids. They've grown up. They're educated in the universities. They went and worked in the government departments or other places. They find that they have a memory of the beautiful environment where they grew up. They find a partner who is coming back, and so on. Of course, I'm not saying we have achieved the target, and also the business of farming, the importance of farming is getting, and say they bring some technology, both computer technology and other technologies back to the farm. But we need to attract more youth and more city people to the farm and the importance of food. So an average farmer in Australia produce enough food to feed 150 people home and 450 people overseas. That's about 60 million people. And that's a big thing. They are doing it, of course, they want to do have a life, but in addition to that, they are feeding 600 people, which is quite important.
Lachlan, you are someone who has grown up on a farm, come to Perth, work in politics. Mm. I mean, is it your, how do you see the flow of, I guess, people to and from the country? And is your intention to go back and work on them without actually, I don't know if your parents are here, but.
Yeah. No, it is a good question, and it's a raise which every country family probably faces. And your question is totally right. Governments do have a role to play, both state and federal governments. They need to make regional towns and cities livable, because as a young male or female, why would you go back to a regional town if there is no sporting facilities, no social fabric of a community there? And I think it's a really prevalent issue in Western Australia because we are such a centralised state. You know, all of our population, something like 80%, live in metropolitan Perth, whereas we've got massive regional hub centres like Kalgoorlie, Albany and Geraldton that have enormous potential and opportunity. And I spoke on developing northern Western Australia at the University of Tokyo in Japan last year, and much of my presentation was around how we're engaging with Aboriginal people in remote areas, but what factors does government need to do to facilitate that? And that is through investment. I don't like when government come and tell agriculture what to do or put in regulations, but they need to facilitate that investment. So whether it's free trade agreements and the like. But it's also, you're right, the image of agriculture again and the dialogue in which we talk about our industry and how we partnered up with medicine and engineering and the economic side of things. Little things like the Royal Agricultural Society, the Perth Show. Everyone knows it as the Perth Show, but if we put that word agriculture back in there and have interactive displays with kids to show where their food comes and actually make them appreciate it, rather than, Four Corners have done a story on the live export trade, how woeful are farmers? Well, it's actually the supply chain that got that one wrong, with the middleman being the live exporter rather than the farmer. So sometimes we do get a bad rap. We need to make agriculture sexy again, if I can say that. and that will then encourage younger people through coming and studying the natural and life sciences at fantastic institutions like UWA. So I think it's good that we need to change that dialogue, and I think it's happening. So I don't think it can be all doom and gloom.
Are there jobs in that sector? Can you come and study something like this? And I mean, where do you go and work on a farm for a... For a company cooperative?
And Sadiq would probably be better to answer this one as well, but I think agricultural science, a graduate from UWA that studies agricultural science is the most employable graduate. There's something like 30 jobs to every one graduate or something like that. So there's massive, the banking industry, you could go and work for your local livestock branch of Landmark or Elders. There are so many employment opportunities. And myself, for example, I'm working for a private agricultural company at the moment, and I haven't even graduated from my undergraduate degree. Sorry, Sadiq. but it's also about agriculture being innovative, because it really is, and it's an exciting technology space to be in. So the company that I'm working for, if I could have 2 minutes of your time, is we're creating so currently in Australia, the meat charts that we're buying meat in supermarkets and the like, from a substandard meat chart produced by MLA, your sirloins and that kind of stuff. And we're exporting cattle, both live and frozen, into these markets that don't necessarily want those cuts of meat. So how do we then develop a Chinese cut meat chart to actually suit their market, because obviously their food is different and the way that they prepare and cook food is entirely different. And to actually train our abattoirs in Australia to those cut specifications so we can actually meet that that potential market there at home. So there's so many exciting things happen. I don't know why anyone wouldn't want to come and work in ag.
Just before going, I think Lachlan has mentioned about the job opportunities. There are 3,000 to 5,000 jobs advertised every year in Australia related to agriculture degree and so on. The whole Australia, not all universities have got agriculture science program. So we only graduate about 750 graduates per year. So you can see there is a real gap between the graduates we produce and the number of jobs. So hence a lot of graduates from other disciplines come in, but the employer is telling me that it's a huge cost for them because they have to train them for 1 or 2 years because they had no clue about what is agriculture about. So there's exciting opportunities, excellent potential.
As someone who grew up on a broadacre farm, so it's wheat and sheep, it's heartening to hear the panel talk about the Southwest adapting to climate change. Every 10 years, the farm I grew up on is about 120 kilometres closer to what we would have called desert. Keeping those innovations in mind, what does the panel think about the more macroeconomic or the countrywide economics of farming, mainly in terms of offshore investment into farms? I appreciate that countries such as China are trying to ensure their food security for the next century. I'm not sure because many of my the people I grew up with are bound by non-disclosure agreements, but the farm that I grew up on is now surrounded by offshore-owned farms. And secondly, in terms of government support, the farm that I grew up on, when I turned 12, we had $60,000 worth of debt because we bought an extra 1,000 acres. Now it's $4.5 million worth of debt on a farm that's valued at $5 million. And that's considered, oh, you've still got equity. That economic education and also from a government perspective, I guess, what does the panel think?
Okay, so I think firstly, as the developing countries that are growing are going to demand better quality food, right? So for instance, the fastest growing countries in Asia are, you know, India, China, and Indonesia. They are neighbors, and they have huge populations as well. So there is going to be a huge demand for high quality produce from Australia. And Siddiq will tell you that India demands chickpeas a lot, and it's a staple part of their diet. And most of the chickpeas is exported from here, right?
Australia is the largest exporter
of chickpeas, and whereas it's not such a fundamental part of the Australian diet. So what we're seeing is farming is shifting towards the needs of the export sector, and from that we can see incomes increasing in the farming sector. But as Lachlan pointed out, there is scope for Australians to enter into agriculture and maybe expand that sector. And I think the government is trying to develop the northeast, northern corridor. And yeah, it's important to create country towns, create infrastructure, create good transportation and so on, so that we don't rely only on mining in Western Australia. And also, agriculture is a big export of WA as well. Wheat exports are huge. So, so I think there is scope to expand on agriculture, and particularly now with our with the climate change impacts, and we're seeing that Australia is very dry as well. So there is huge scope, I think, in agriculture. And yeah, let these two.
Yeah, I think briefly, you're right about the climate change. Earlier that mention has been there. Australia is the driest human inhabited continent in the world. So for the last 200 years, if you look at all the things we are seeing today has been imported into this country and we adapted. For example, wheat all the time used to come from England and we had to starve here. And the first lot of wheat was planted in Botany Bay in Sydney, no more agriculture there. 8 bags of purple straw, the oldest variety, was planted. Miserably failed because that is a long photo period, strong cold requirement. the British within. And from there, you know the famous Farrer. He's a mathematician. He started the crossing wheat breeding program. Now in the Parliament House, somewhere there, he was a clerk in Canberra. And we had a $2 note those days. That's disappeared. What a shame. So Farrer started, and he said, all the British wheat will not survive in Australia. Then he started bringing wheat from India and Kenya. They were colonies, and started the hybridization program. The first wheat federation was bred and variety. From there now, Australia is one of the four countries in the world exporting up to 25 million tons of wheat. It's not big in terms of production because China produces 120 million tons of wheat. India produces about 85 million tons of wheat. But most of this is exported because we have a small population. We have a comparative advantage of extensive farming using technology. In other words, West Australian farmers are the most efficient in the world in terms of per unit of rainfall, they produce X unit of grain. That's through technology, the varieties, no-till technology, the farmers' innovation. Where do we go further? I think we have to consolidate. We don't need the 17 to 20 million hectares in the southwest corner. We may now move into probably 10 to 12 million hectares. We will use innovative technologies, including nutrient use efficiency, new breeds, and animal production system, target the market, as Anu mentioned, and then make money. If you take the top 25% of the farmers in Western Australia, they're doing very well, except in extremely dry years. So there will be some inefficient farmers will move out. Regarding foreign investment, I think the main way is that the partnership is the way to go. For example, the Kidman property, it is 70% owned by Gina Reinhardt, only 30% by the Shanghai-based Mr. Gui. So we need to see someone prepared to invest money into farming. And farmers or your parents, good farmers, needs to be partnership. Because I don't think the Chinese guys can come and do farming in Australia. They don't know the technology. We need Australian farmers and innovators to farm.
Yeah.
And so,
after you, James.
Yeah.
Oh, I was just going to say, is that a concern, the foreign investment in?
Well, we'll ask back to the question. Is it a concern? I'm not a farmer, but I think we need to have a partnership. I don't like to have someone coming and owning the whole land and driving our farmers out.
Okay.
We want to have farmers, and they drive it, but a partnership. Instead of borrowing the money from the bank, if I'm prepared to put X million dollars into the farm, why not make an agreement?
There's a few points, and there's a really good question, and it's something that we're facing at the moment. I think foreign investment, again, around the dialogue is gets a bit of a bad rap. I'm actually a supporter of foreign investment. I think it's a good thing, and within partnerships, because in WA specifically, we do agriculture really well. We were the first bunch to do no-till farming because, we were getting less and less rain, and we weren't making any money from it. So the foreign investment, I think, is a good thing. But Sadiq is right that, they need to partner up with the current farmers on the land who actually know how to farm. There was a case in Esperance that a Chinese company had bought a feedlot, and the feedlot was closed within 6 months because they thought they knew how to run a farming organisation, but they couldn't. You're right, we farmers are very risk averse when it comes to borrowing capital, and they don't want to get those big debts. And growing up in the wheat belt as well, there's only two families, whereas there was five, because the notion of get big or get out is quite prevalent, especially in the eastern wheat belt. But your question around what the government should do, I think. Governments need to start, and I'm not going to name any parties, but at the last state election, it was, I think, 4 days out from polling day where the four parties that were at play to win political seats had an agricultural policy. Now, that's a joke. Like, we are the second biggest contributing industry to Western Australia's economy, and they had an agricultural policy 4 days out from the election. So I think political parties and governments need to take agriculture much more seriously. And see it as a real opportunity to enhance and diversify our economy.
I think there's a question up here. Thank you for waiting.
Thanks, sir. Fascinating discussion. The my particular interest at present having been a retired farmer and orchardist and involved in international sustainable agriculture in forums, is urban agriculture and the way it can be applied in remote and regional communities. So the discussion has been very apt, and I guess my question would be, I'll say one more thing prior to that. I think we should remember, standing on what Aboriginal people see as stolen lands belonging to them, that prior to our society's arrival, this whole country was a fresh food supermarket or community garden with no cash registers. People only took what they needed and they shared. So obviously things have changed a lot since then, and I'm not being super critical. I wonder what role agriculture has in addressing things like the sense of alienation, the health gaps, the lack of enterprise in remote and regional Aboriginal communities, and perhaps more importantly, drawing upon their cultural knowledge, which has been gained on this land over such a long period of time. Thank you.
Do you want to start? I did my paper exactly on your question, presenting it in Japan. You're right, Aboriginal people have a lot to offer the agricultural industry, and they have done because it's what they have done for thousands upon thousands of years. And some of the Aboriginal people from some of the best, like I said, some of the best stock people on stations are Aboriginal people. So I went to a forum the other day at EY, run by the Kimberley Land Council, and it was about social entrepreneurship and how industry and business can enable Aboriginal people through social businesses. And there's the Ranger program that the former state government put in place to have that connection of Aboriginal people to come back to their land, and how they can sort of get the knowledge and experience of the Aboriginal people and share it with everyday tourists and make it a tourism hub, I suppose. So, when they're going out and capturing turtles off the coast of Broome, bring five people in the boat and charge them $3,000 each and, have that experience through Aboriginals teaching them what to do. It's a hard one because I think Siobhan would be able to talk about this, about how the social values and, their nutritional impact of rural communities and remote communities is a big thing. I don't have the answer, to be honest. Yeah.
I think it is worth looking at very seriously, especially in relation to Grow North. The Australian government is now looking at the whole agriculture situation in the north. That includes Queensland, Northern Territory, and north of Western Australia. There is some programs being developed where number of enterprises. It's not going to be like Southern Australian agriculture where broad acre. It will be mosaic of agriculture, whether it is aquaculture, whether it is forestry, whether it is tropical fruit production or tropical dairy. How do we bring the community and empower them with the technology so that we have a sustainable? It may not be just like what they did millions of years ago or whatever. It will be a different form where they feel ownership. And it is great that Forrest, Nicola and Andrew Forrest, bringing Aboriginal communities to their farm and the operation in Varuna, the meat factories and so on. So I think we need to take that on board, start from the north, because the south is almost taken up and gone into a different perspective. It is possible. We could make money, and also at the same time, they feel ownership of the land, they are empowered, and that kind of model we need to look. I think the both governments, state governments and federal government, are serious about it. If there is going to be agriculture in Australia, Northern Australia, we must seriously consider the involvement of Aborigines in a very active form. Wait.
There's almost a parallel with what we were talking about before and about the issues in, I think, Indonesia and India about wastage at the farm gate, transport, logistic issues. In in WA, you know, in those very remote communities. They have similar, I mean, the, you know, appalling, terrible malnutrition rates, you know, don't have access to fresh fruit and vegetables because it's logistically, I guess, more expensive to get them out there. So it's sort of, you can kind of look very far away to see something that's happening, you know, right where we are.
A lot of the nutrition knowledge was lost. With white settlement. So when we, as white settlers, started employing Aboriginals on local farms, their pay was in rations of refined white flour and things that that we used and knew how to use, but was quite foreign to them. So the Aboriginal damper that they used to make was collected with nuts that they would crush up and add water to, so a very nutritious kind of damper. If you compare that to refined white flour with water added to it now, it's a completely different story. And so their actual food that they're receiving is different, but then also that nutrition knowledge was just lost. And if you think of most of what we know about nutrition, it's from what our parents taught us. And if you just, you know, with white settlement, just stop that flow on of information, then you've got to build that base again and draw on where we do have people that have local knowledge and bring them in to build up that education.
Is that something that's happening at the moment? Or?
Not that I'm aware of, but I'm not really working in that area. But I'm certainly heartened to hear that there's, you know, a lot of it used in the agricultural area.
Just quickly, so there's clearly huge scope here for bringing on board potential for new grains, new crops, etc., from native species that we haven't explored or that maybe they were looking at back before white settlement, etc., etc. I talked around that a little bit this morning because of the seed flame innovation that's in the banquet hall. So I think a bit like Sadiq talked about, we could use that knowledge but then couple it with modern technology to help us actually achieve that in sort of, I don't know, a broad acre context or something that can actually contribute even in the big picture with lots of new scope.
Do you have a question?
Sort of a question statement. When I was seeding 40 years ago and much younger, we were battling to do 100 acres a day. Now you can easily do 1,000 acres a day for effectively the same sort of team. So farming has changed, you know, considerably. And not only that's 10 times, but also you could seed in a much lower, shorter time frame, which is, you know, highly beneficial. Yes, I left the farm 40 years ago, but I've sort of gone back to agriculture in the form of beekeeping, which I live in Kensington. I've got some hives there, and as John mentioned about urban beekeeping, though I've actually got more than two beehives and scattered around the place, urban beekeeping, you can probably, with two hives, you could probably produce 200 kilos of honey, which is not bad going, as long as not living out in somewhere that are just wall-to-wall houses. So things have changed, but also I believe that farmers themselves, about, you know, no social life in towns, farmers themselves are their worst enemies, is at seeding and harvesting time, they want to pay basic wages, which is now a very short time frame. When I was harvesting down at Grass Patch, our aim was to finish by Australia Day. Now they're well and truly finished before Christmas.
Yeah.
So by only employing people for a very short period, what are they supposed to do the rest of the year if they're going to stay in the rural areas?
Yeah, I suppose that's another, that's an interesting issue about the labour conditions for people that are employed in agriculture in Australia. Lachlan, I'm not sure if you've got, you know, sort of a comment on that, but I certainly, when they were talking about the so-called backpacker tax and that was going to be an issue, it does seem that some of those conditions are pretty are not great.
Yeah, I liken this situation to my brother, who's 25 or 6. I had dinner with him last night, and he was someone who worked on the mines for probably 5 or 6 years as a tradesperson, then came back on the farm, and, you know, probably quartered his pay. So you're right, your pay, the pay there's. Agriculture is not like a unionised industry, or, you know, there's never been a really industrial relations side around it.
So yeah, it is a conversation that needs to be had, and the backpacker tax, and especially within those orchard growing areas. But yeah, I agree with you on the social level. You know, sometimes they are their worst enemy. But rural communities don't just comprise of farmers; they comprise of every other sector within the community as well.
I think we are not going to see the same way we have been doing farming and the community living together. Every bit of towns had 100 people and 25 children and the schools and so on. I think things are consolidating. We are seeing significant number of fly in and fly out. The farmers are living closer to the coastal areas, whether it is Esperance, Geraldton, Perth, Albany and so on. And what will happen is that the cropping and animal enterprises are changing. In the cropping zone, you don't need to be there every day. So you will have a manager if you have a 20,000 hectare property, and there will be a house, and you will fly in, and you do this seeding operation within 7 days, as you mentioned, with the satellite technology, GPS, GIS, wonderful technology, and you treat that and get out. You need to tune on to the weather forecasting. Unfortunately, we don't have good weather, good rain this year. And so this is going to be there, and then people will move to the coastal areas. Their families will be there. So you will be aggregation of communities like that. So you won't have at Cunderdin, then nearby town, etc. population. And that is the reality we have to face. So what are the social drivers? And we have some significant people within this university undertaking such research. What are the drivers? Can we look next 20 years? What will be happening? What will be the population dynamics in Australia? What will be the farmer dynamics? So we need such kind of studies, and then design system. And you talked about the urban and peri-urban agriculture. This is very important. If you're going to have new cities in Joondalup or somewhere, even after Manjira, we need to start thinking about it. Can we have a design, architect designed, and harvesting the solar energy, recycling the water, producing at least 30% of the food? You know, we can't produce wheat and you can't have everything there. Possible.
I think there's another question.
Hey guys, my question would be, obviously a lot of the concepts we've discussed today have been on quite a large scale, whether it be readdressing international transportation of produce or re-examining how we actually look at the expansion of civilization on the land, and also obviously all that sort of thing. But what my question is, how can we, on sort of a smaller level or like an individual level, how can we make an impact on not only assisting in that, things like buying local produce, but how can we also help address the issue to people who are a bit more oblivious to how serious the issue is?
Stop feeding them.
I think that's probably the question that's at the root of particularly, Siobhan, your work. You know, it's, I mean.
Look, that's a fabulous question. And certainly, I think I said earlier, in dietary terms, we've known what to do for a long time. But news is particularly good at this. And we're also very good at this. We want a quick fix. We want a quick solution. We don't want to eat the veggies on our plate or, you know, have to go for a walk to the shop to buy them. We want to hop in our car and go and get the instant food. So how we actually change the behaviour, I don't have the answers for yet, but there's certainly a big research space available there. On an individual level, personally, I believe if we just make that behaviour change ourselves and advocate it for it amongst our friends, then as we get more of a groundswell, we might see the scales tipping in the balance to actually see some change. Yeah. We do also need government coming in and talking to Big Food, because Big Food are like Big Tobacco, and we can't blame them. They have to answer to their shareholders, and they aim to sell more food, not just to us, but certainly in the emerging economies, and they have very aggressive marketing programs in the emerging economies to sell more food for their shareholders. And if the government's not stepping in to apply policies that can restrict some of that, or perhaps policies that are more positive to enhance more fruit and veg availability, we're not going to see that change, making that change very easy for the individual.
I think, from my perspective anyway, the media perspective, is that we polarise everything. And, you know, it seems that the debate is either big food on one side and then people who, want to live in a entirely sustainable way, which is impractical for many people on the other side of it. And the thing that helps is having conversations like what you suggested about in a reasonable way, you know, which most people do. It's just the public conversations are polarised. And there's not enough people. You don't have to be, you know, a died-on member of any particular type of thinking to go, well, how can we change things so they're a bit better? And it's those, yeah, I don't know. I think it's having those kind of conversations.
Our approach needs to be a little bit like this panel too. It needs to be across the board. We get messages from the media about chia seeds, goji berries, whatever it is that we think is going to be the solution. But we don't eat single foods. We eat something different for breakfast, for lunch, for dinner. Today, Sunday, the breakfast you probably had today was probably different to what you have Monday to Friday, different in winter and summer. It's a whole... We have to put any new food into the whole context of diet and the change that a few chia seeds are going to make to the whole of diet are, minimal.
I think some of these things has to start in the school curriculum education because kids doesn't know. There was a survey about 3 years ago, 4 years ago, the Canberra students were asked a number of questions. One of them is, where is yogurt coming from? They wrote, from plants. So that's bad as Singaporean students. Singaporean students, they were asked, where is milk coming from? They said, it is coming from a tin. And that's what Diana wrote in her school. So there's a lot of education has to come from the school age. Then Australian agriculture and food production is one of the most innovative. We are so lucky in terms of pesticide residue and so on. You go to places like China, they don't want to feed their kids with the milk and so on. They want to bring some of the milk powder and things from Australia. So the quality of the food, the farmers are also innovative in terms of sustainability, and they do produce their food with minimal input compared with a lot of European farmers. So the good stories are not getting into the press. Always drought, miserable, and farmers are clearing land. They're all not new stories. They're all old stories. So we need to look at the positive image of food production rather than agriculture out there, including health and well-being.
We're almost out of time, so we'll take that question.
I have a few comments and questions. First of all, as you said, education is very important, especially the younger generations. So far, I've only known 3 primary schools that have their own green growing garden. They are funding for over $20,000 per school for playground, but the funding is not going towards teaching the kids how to grow. And that's where we were talking about 2050, so that's where we should start, number one. And number two is that we're talking about growing and building and having more land. What about the wastage? And from the education, if somebody knows how difficult it is to grow a tomato, they would not throw away the one with one black spot. So I'm not sure what can be done or whether it's lobbying with the governments or the local to do that.
So I totally agree. I think that we need to come at it from, and encourage government to have positive things like incentives to actually encourage stuff instead of regulation, like you mentioned, Lachlan, before. I totally agree. Obviously, it is all about education and educating the youth and that we're more aware of what's happening. They are the future, obviously. I have young twin daughters myself, and I'm worried about in this sort of technological age with constant bombardment of advertising and smartphones, etc. I don't have one myself for that very reason. Just like the distractions and things, the pressures that are on modern society, it's quite tricky because of that aspect. And I think I'm going to go slightly sideways for a second. With the wastage issue, there's even thinking about, say, even with urbanisation and building new houses in certain areas or whatever, like there's opportunities there for removing, say, that topsoil that's fertile, moving it somewhere else where it can be used still to grow plants instead of building houses over the top of it. Like there's even simple things like that, or it doesn't make sense to have that particular area infill that was once a lake or something, like, leave it for agriculture, and maybe it'll help facilitate some of these ideas about urbanisation and having food produced locally.
Anyway. Were there any final questions?
Just one.
Okay, that'll be the last one.
Just building, I guess, on the last two questions that have come up. I'm a formerly obese yuppie. I'm now just a badly overweight yuppie. And having grown up on a farm, I'm also a medical doctor who specialises in weight loss. I didn't learn how to cook until someone pointed out it was the best way to get a second date. Because I learned how to cook.
I mean, that's probably the reason why most men learn to cook.
Let's have a conversation. Oh, I think you've hit the nail on the head. That's what we need, is that. Communicate that.
But working, I guess, from on one tier as an economics, it was easier to justify eating out and working an extra hour financially. And it wasn't until I learnt, actually got educated on, and this is, you know, after working 4 years as a doctor, that I learnt how to actually cook at home and how to use fresh produce, that I started to lose weight, which worked out to about 20 kilos over the space of over 2 years. That I went through a private boarding school, I grew up in a farming household, that we don't have that education coming in at the grassroots for diet, exercise, where food comes from. And if I can pose it as a question, particularly aimed at Professor Hinkling, with things like Jamie's school dinners and the Good Guys food truck, from a dietary perspective, have you seen any changes taking place or taking hold coming through, I guess, even just the Perth Society?
Look, that's a great question, and I don't think we have enough data yet to say whether that has had a positive change, but things like Jamie's school dinners, MasterChef, it is at least showing people food and showing them how to cook. In my whole undergraduate degree in nutrition and dietetics, there was no cooking. It was just assumed that you knew that. And I wonder about those students now, whether any of them actually know how to cook. It's the language that they need to speak with their clients one-on-one, and it's not part of that undergraduate university education. But going back even further and to the previous question, it does need to come in much, much earlier. But I think we need the Faculty of Education here, because the school curriculum is so crammed that if we add that in, what comes out? And teachers are pretty overwhelmed with everything that they have to teach our kids.
Clearly there's an opportunity here even for it to happen, I hate the word, organically. In the household, like if you're actually cooking in front of your children, then I'm sure that they can see that that's
absolutely
normal and stuff, and not have the pressure on the school.
Yeah, but the parents don't necessarily have that knowledge now, so that's been lost a bit and needs to come from the kids.
I think we don't need to change the entire curriculum or develop the curriculum. What when we teach, for example, chemistry, you include the context-based thing, so how to make wine, not for the little kids, but for the high school students, the chemistry of chemistry of wine making. You know, you get whole chemistry from soils to the pH to the plant growth, all the microbes, all those things. Instead of just doing something and teaching some theory, context based. Okay, photosynthesis. Okay, carbon dioxide is taken up, the water is moving, the energy is trapped, and we produce wheat. So X amount of water will produce X amount of wheat in Western Australia. So you can context-based physics, chemistry, biology, and nutrition into the classroom and take an apple. Apple got a lot of pectins. And what does the pectins do to the health? And Western Australia has recently released a new variety of apple called Bravo. That is a combination of Department of Agriculture people, UWA, plant biologists and medicos got together, and the marketing people got together. So you can have a context base. So education faculty is very important. Teach the teachers, train the teachers, next generation, so that we can have a wonderful new generation.
Well, that's a great note to end it on, I think. Please thank Hacker Professor Kadambot Sadiq, Dr. Andrew Gazomi, Professor Anu Ramahan, Lachlan Hunter, and Assistant Professor Siobhan Hickling. thanks so much. Thanks for coming out on a Sunday as well, you guys. You might, I don't know if you, I guess if you stick around. Yeah, yeah.
you're at the risk of being, you know, asked questions. So that if you bolt, then no one can ask you. So if there's anything you'd like to put to the panel, just stick around. But thank you so much. Thanks for UWA for having me. And I hope you enjoyed the panel session. Thanks.
Thank you, James.
Thank you. You're welcome. Thanks.